this very interesting lecture did not fatigue you at all. As Helmut already mentioned, I'm a structural engineer and scientist. I work with Helmut since 19 years now. And I think we developed a series of buildings, of building details, of building solutions, which stand for themselves. But however, I do not want to continue showing you structural systems or whatever. I want to introduce a little bit in the basics of our thinking. And at the very beginning, you will be surprised and ask yourself the question, what is he telling us? This does not relate to this congress at all. I hope that at the end of my talk, you agree that it relates very much to what we are talking here, especially when we talk about high-rise buildings in urban context. This is a diagram we all know since we were young. It is 1973, the first report of the Club of Rome, talking about the explosion of the population. We didn't take care of that diagram. We just said, okay, we don't believe it, and we continued and worked in another direction. In a direction which was characterized by deconstructivism, postmodernism, and whatever, trends and fashions which were simply gone from the standpoint from nowadays, and which characterize a period in time sloterdijk, the German philosopher Sloterdijk, one of the most prominent philosophers in Europe, actually calls the lost decades. So when I talk about those things, I just want to finger point on a few issues and make you aware of the dimensions we have to deal with in the upcoming years, making it very clear that we have a series of chances what we can realize being architects and engineers, but that we also can fail in a very horrible way. Before this explosion started, everyone thought that at the turn of the millennium we'll live in the Sahara, in Arctica, and Antarctica, in cities like this. There was a very, very positive reception of the future. Think about the Concorde, the invention of plastic, and all those things. So we all thought, even me being a small boy, this is where you will live when you're retired. Didn't happen at all, as we all know. This is where the human beings are living. Millions and billions in cities like this. Just remember a few numbers, because this is important for my talk. At 1900, world's population was about 1.6 billion, milliarden, as we say. In the 50s, this was 2.5. In the 90s, 5.3. 2000, 6.2 billion. And 2013, 7.1. That means, simply spoken, we have out there about 2 to 2.5 billion people still living at home. And those 2 to 2.5 young people, they will need an apartment, housing, a working place, and infrastructure within the next 18 years. Now, 2.5 billion was the world's population after World War I at around the 30s. But that means if you want to build a world for these young people, that we have to add something to our already existing built environment in the volume of the world as it existed in 1930. And this should give you an idea on the volume we are talking about. And if we do this world from 1930 once more, then we still have the living conditions of the 30s, which we all overcame in the last 70 to 80 years. Means in Germany, from a square meter level in typical housing, from 2015 to now 82 average apartment, or per capita from 10 to 12 to now 42. So if we would even take this into account, then we would have to build the world from 1930 two to three times, which is an act of impossibility. Next number is this diagram, very trivial, very well known by everybody, but I just finger point once more onto it. We see the primary energy consumption for different types of cities, and in the very lower part you see Tokyo, Singapore, the central European city, which are characterized by a high density and relatively small volumes of individual traffic, whereas there is a 6 to 7 times higher energy consumptions, especially in the northern part of America, Houston, Detroit, San Francisco, New York, etc. This is characterized and caused by non-today standard insulation, non-today's standard heating and cooling technology, and by car traffic, which consumes far more than they should. But what are you going to do with this once we realize that this might be a problem too? Is this the solution, as the Central European state, that high rises are nothing for people to live in? In Germany, the big trend, no building higher than 5 stories, except maybe a few buildings in Frankfurt. Helmut Jahn mentioned that in Munich, they introduced the building law and limited the height of the buildings to 80 to 90 meters. So is this then what we are facing? And of course, we will not survive this, because the combustion of the fuel and the emittance of the CO2 would be such, with this rapidly increasing population, that, and even now the American government realized and admits that we have a CO2, means a global warming problem, that the global warming problem will be accelerated instead be slowed down. Scientists like we are no longer believe that we will be able up to 2050 to limit the warming of the globe to 2 degrees, not at all. If you look at the typical curves, at the consumption and the emissions curve, there is no indication that this will happen. So let's face the fact that we have an exploding population and that we are facing huge problems we have to deal with. Now, we have an emission problem. We don't have an energy problem. The sun radiates onto the globe 10,000 times more energy than all human being needs for all their functions, 10,000 times more. The only problem is we have to harvest this energy, we have to store it, and we have to release it when we need it. This is a technological problem we should be able to solve. We talk about money later on. And we can be able to solve that up to 2050. And then we would walk into the what I call the solar age, where we have no energy problem at all. Great for architect. Because then we can come back to this nice and filigree design of the 50s, where we did not have to wrap around our buildings decimeters of styrofoam in order to make them whatever insulated. So we don't have an energy problem in the solar age. We have an energy problem in the transition phase from now to 2050. And there we have to be very careful with the energy, because this energy is typically fuel-based, and we are running out of fuel. Besides all the stories about fracking, which I really fear, because fracking will be cheap energy, we will not yield to reduced emissions, because there is no reason to reduce emission if the fuel is cheap. But everyone in the meantime agrees that this so-called depletion midpoint diagram has something to do with reality. So the diagram was invented in 1956 by a researcher from the Shell company, and he was not allowed to publish that because it would have been a shock for everyone. Now, he left, became a professor very famous in the United States, and in the meantime, all research institutions in the world agreed that this diagram has a certain quality to predict what happens. This diagram does nothing else than telling us when 50% of the petroleum, which exists, known exists, is gone. And all scientists agreed that this so-called depletion midpoint was around 2010. It might be 2015. We don't talk about plus minus 10 years, because we have to look at another number. This diagram tells us that nowadays, probably 50% of the petroleum are gone. Now again, remember the population. 1900, it was 1.6 billion. Average of the last centennium was about 2.5. The industrial production of petroleum started 1880, 1890 in Baku in Azerbaijan, and at around 1900 in Texas. So from 1900 to 2000, an average population of 2.5 billion consumed 50%. Now we have 7.1 billion. And it's a relatively trivial calculation to predict that if we, on a consumption level of about 1950, means every fifth person has a car, which is not true at all, will consume the rest in less than 30 years. And we should be aware of that fact. And if it is 40 years or if it is 50 years, this is no problem at all, because this comes along with a population explosion and an increased consumption, which will draw the timeline back to 20, 30 years. So what we have to do is avoid like devil that we burn, that we combust this very precious material called coal or petroleum, because we need it to produce plastic, to produce artificial arterias, to produce glasses which weigh 1.6 grams apiece, and things like this. And this affects very much what we are doing as architects and engineers, as this aspect affects also very much what we are doing. This is the waste production. Building industry stands for 60% of waste production in the world. It means every one of you who is designing something but does not consider the design for disassembly has quite a responsibility for what is happening here. So our built environment, which we are designing, stands for 60% of the consumption of resources, mass waste production, energy consumption, and these huge numbers are multiplied bigger with a big lever arm, as I did in my, explained you in my introductory words, with this necessity to build the world of 1930 one or two times more within the next 18 years. However, a lot of effort has been done. I finger point on the development in Central Europe, which is especially Germany, Austria, Switzerland, and the northern part of Italy, where a lot of research has been done in reducing the heating energy consumption. The blue line is the German energy saving code for new built residentials, and the orange line is the avant-garde, is the scientific world, means these are the better ones which had to achieve better solutions than the code, the norm prescribes, of course. And you see that already in 2000 we were able to produce zero heating energy buildings. Nowadays, the Germany energy saving code requires about 80 kilowatt hours per square meter in your year not to be exceeded. Similar to Switzerland, similar to Austria. Very sense-making, but with this formulation of a target, the solution already came along, and unfortunately, the solution was scientifically not really proven. This is wrapping around of insulation, making tiny windows, make them absolutely airtight, and make the entire building airtight. So if you want to have some subsidies for your interest rates, if you want to have some subsidies from the government, tax reduction, etc., you must prove before you move into your house that the box is airtight. I cannot imagine to live in an airtight box. Despite the fact that we should ask the question, how much energy do we need to produce the styrofoam we wrap around our buildings, and how much energy will we save with it? Taking the perspective of 2050 as the entrance door to the solar age, we should just, if we would be scientists, bring our buildings with a minimum of effort into that age. But what is the intersection of the two curves? The energy pumped into the production of the insulating material and the heating energy you save with that material. It is 16 centimeters for a building in Germany, 16 centimeters, which is roughly 5 inches. The actual building code requires 20 to 30 centimeters of insulation. Means nowadays, we put more embodied energy in the insulation of our buildings than we will ever save with it. However, this energy issue, especially the energy cost issue, is something which is politically quite dangerous, and it is a danger for social stability. Look at this. This is Germany, the development of energy costs. I make it simple, and I take two of those curves, and what you see here is heating oil and electricity. The costs for the end users, means for the normal person, doubled in 10 years. In the meantime, heating cost is something many poor German families, and this is still a nation which belongs to the richest in the world, cannot longer afford. There is about 100,000 families in Germany which are not longer able to pay their electricity bill. Another interesting effect. Look at those three curves, and first look at the green one. This is the positive influence of a very restrictive code, reduce the consumption of energy for heating. So we reduced that consumption by about 40% during the last 35 years. Big success. Now look at the pink curve. This is the living area per person. It indicates that the living area doubled. So if we would be politicians, we would say, we reduce the energy consumption per square meter by 50%. Applause. If we are scientists, we say, nothing happened. All the efforts were gone because if I double the living area and I reduce the heating per square meter, I, at the end, gain nothing per capita. So politically, we should switch the unit. We should not longer talk about per square meter or per square foot, we should talk per capita. But this then is a political blow up, because you then look at every individual and you tell him this and not more, what politicians fear. But from a scientific standpoint, the only way to go. Interestingly, the Swiss people in Zurich, they decided on the 2000 Watt Gesellschaft, 2000 Watt Society, which is a limitation of the energy consumption per capita. They also decided in a poll to the limitation of the CO2 exhaust per capita. And they said, we, the Swiss, we are going to reduce that up to 2050 to 1 ton per capita a year. Just to give you an idea, 1 ton per capita a year, if you have a tiny car, like a smart car, you can go 10,000 kilometers and then you have 1 ton. So nothing else is allowed. No aircraft flying, no whatever. I stick to the simple numbers and ask another very simple question. Building new buildings is the one thing, but the big problem for our built environment is the existing environment, the existing built environment. Take the example Germany. Germany has about 40 million habitats, residential, 2-3 family houses, flats, out of which there are 35 million which need an energetic refurbishment renovation. One habitat in Germany has 82 square meters, multiplied by 35 million, multiplied by a very, very low number of 500 euros per square meter for the renovation, yields to a total number of 1,435 billion euros. Unaffordable, undoable, even not for Germany. 1,400 billions to be invested only in housing, existing one, in the next 15 to 20 years. Undoable. But there's no answer coming from the architectural and engineering world to the politicians. There is no answer out there because we forgot to do the research necessary to be done. But if we cannot afford what we should achieve, if we don't have 30,000 bucks per apartment, we have to ask the question, what if we have 1,000? What should we do? What is the most effective measure to be taken for energy saving if I have just 1,000? If the society is able to spend 1,000 per habitat? In the end, surprisingly, you found out it's something like home automation with an individual room control, which is, of course, applicable to offices and to everything else which is built, but which is not very familiar. So luckily, a couple of former students of mine, they developed such a house, a home automation system, which does not need any wiring, which is based on your iPhone or whatever, where you invest less than 10 euro per square meter, and depending on the actual condition of your apartment, you save between 15 and 40% of heating energy. So we should not fear to introduce high tech in our so often low tech buildings, otherwise we won't make it. With a low tech approach to wrap insulation and to exchange the windows and whatever, we won't get the target. We, and this is a building, Helmut and I were working for thousands of hours. We designed it, by the way, we won the competition with a design we designed over the phone, Helmut. You might remember those long evenings. And the solution came at about midnight Central European time. At those times, we were still faxing and phoning and developing the building. This Deutsche Post building is the first in the world which shows not only a decentralized heating and cooling system where every individual can regulate his air supply volume and the temperature, it is also the first in the world which has a double facade, which has several thousand openings, glazed flaps, Helmut already mentioned them, which can be opened and closed depending on the wind direction and the wind speed in such a way that we have a smooth air flush running in between the outer and the inner skin. So that in even the worstest weather condition, you might open the window and breathe the fresh air without risking that your paperwork is flying away. This was about 2000 when we developed that, and I think this is still an outstanding solution out there. And of course, the building took half a year to make it really perfectly working because it is a prototype. And if you have several thousand of those glazed flaps, if you have several thousand of heating and cooling boxes able to be run very individually, it takes some time. We further developed that with other colleagues. This building has got the award to be the best high-rise building in the world last year. This is a bank building in Frankfurt, which again has a double skin facade with again, by the work of Matthias Schuler from Transolar, the energy engineer in this case, has a very smooth air flushing between the outer and the inner skin. Very careful, detailed, unitized system. Somehow complicated the facade itself, but due to the prefabrication and easy to install process, to the easy to repair and easy to clean process, a very good solution. I jump over this because we are a little bit short in time. We continue to do those solutions in even more advanced way in this building. This is the German Automotive Club in Munich. Something for the engineer, don't be shocked, but I just want to finger point on two other issues, which will take me 5 minutes. I hope you have the time. Up to now, when we talk about reducing the consumption of resources, we talk about lightweight. This plays the ball in my garden since I'm the professor for lightweight structures. But what we did in former times when we talked about lightweight, we went to search a material where the specific weight in relation to an ability like a strength or a modulus or whatever it might be, a creeping factor, showed the best ratio. So in this case, you see the typical clouds from these famous diagrams from Esch, be concrete or steel, and you ask yourself the question, there's a column out there. Should we do the column with a given load and a given length out of steel or of concrete? If we talk about lightweight, look at those diagrams, it's quite obvious we do it out of steel with an advantage factor of 4 to 5 times being lighter than the concrete solution. So imagine that, remember it. So we did, when we did structures like this, we picked high strength steel. We also did structural lightweight in a way that we undulated the beams. Look at this, wherever a force is introduced, induced with these very, very thin columns, the structural height is increased, very, very logic. And where we have low loading, low bending moments, the structural height is minimized by the fact these things provide a very, very nice patterning. They are absolutely simple. This is not a cost-driving issue at all. It just needs a clever engineering. But remember the other question when I said, how much energy do we pump in our insulation? We also could say, how much embodied energy is in the column? Shouldn't we optimize a column under the aspect of minimizing the embodied energy? The energy we need to find the metal to get it out of the ground, to make a double tier, whatever section out of it, to fabricate it, to bring it on site, and to install it. All that summarized is the embodied energy. And I ask you the same question. There's a column there with a given loading and length. If you want to minimize the weight, we use steel. If we want to minimize the embodied energy, we need to use concrete. 10 times less than steel. So what are we doing? We have two diverting optimization targets, but we have only one column and only one choice. The question is not there, because the scientific world did not deal with that question. We came up with a question a few years ago, but we don't have the book of answers yet. But we ask ourselves other questions. We say, okay, there is an office building with a slab, and it makes very much sense that the slab is horizontal and plain on the top side, because people love to walk on a horizontal plane. And in many cases, it makes sense that the slab is flat and plain on the lower side too. So what do you want to optimize? There's no reason to optimize. There's no chance to optimize. You might squeeze the thickness, but the real optimization is when you look into the slab and when you detect the areas where there is a less stressed area, medium, high. And when you then build in porosities in a way that the density and the distribution of the porosities strictly follows the stress fields. And if you do that very strictly, and we did that, we invented that, we produced that on an experimental level with robots, you end with that. And then given the same capacity of the floor slab, you are able to save up to 60-70% of concrete volume. That means you save 40% of cement. Now taking the fact that the cement production is responsible for 7% of the worldwide CO2 emissions, this is something. Remembering the fact that 7% of CO2 emission due to cement is far more than the entire world's air traffic emits. Last question, and then I come to an end. This is what the German car industry has to fulfill since 1990, a 85% recyclability ratio. Nowadays, a Mercedes S-Class has a 95% recyclability ratio. If you ask an architect, if you ask an engineer, if you ask a contractor about his recyclability ratio, he's probably getting red cheeks. We don't know, because we don't design for that. But we should be aware of the fact how much material we pump into the built environment. This is the biggest waste deposit anthropogenous ever seen. And of course, there is enough iron out there. We could say, why should we take care of the steel and the rare metals? There is enough iron out there in Mongolia and wherever, yes. But the rare metals to make steel out of iron, they are not out there. They are in our buildings. And it's not that difficult to design buildings for disassembly, for recyclability. This is one of my fashions. I'm doing this since many, many years. And not necessarily those buildings might look great. This is a building for the German government which is 100% recyclable and which generates 170% of the energy it needs. It's not expensive. It feeds 2 electric cars, 1 smart, a 2-seater, a 4-seater, and an electric bicycle. And there's still energy left over. So this is not a problem to do that. You just should do it. The government, of course, is very proud on it. Recyclability means that you really struggle with some building codes. Yes, but this flooring here is composed of, I think, 9 or 10 different materials with no drop of glue and with no drop of water. The things are just laid one on top of the other. They fulfill German acoustic requirements, which are, together with the Swiss one, the highest in the world. Fire protection, structural requirements, everything. You just need to do it. And when you are able to do that, then you might even transfer those technologies to very, very tough areas like this high-rise building we are actually doing in Siberia, and where we are keen enough in Siberia with temperatures down to minus 40 degrees Celsius to talk about low-energy buildings, because we applied all what we learned in the last 20 years into those houses. Thank you so much.